Good morning.
Good morning.
And well, is this on?
Oh, no, I don't think so.
Look at it. It was on, it was just turned way down. No, I think I didn't turn it down a little more. All right. Beginning of the worship service, take two. So, good morning. And welcome to our worship here at Norwich Lutheran Church. Just a few announcements to call your attention to before we begin. First of all, today is Rally Sunday. Sunday school kicked off. We had kits being made for Lutheran World Relief and kind of a special service with camp and Sunday school music. And we will be doing a blessing of the backpacks. And just a note on that. When I put this order of service together, I meant to put the blessing of the backpacks in the children's sermon spot, and I didn't, but that's where it will be, so we will do that as for the children's sermon spot. And also, just a note on the offertory song, A La La La, we'll go verse 1, 2, 4, 5, 6, and 7. Verse 3 we will not be doing as is printed in your bulletin, because I don't know what that means, and neither does Kristen, so... So we'll do 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7 as printed in your bulletin. And then just a couple of other announcements. First of all, we're halfway through the month of September. My remaining schedule is I will be here, obviously, today. And then on Wednesday, the 25th, I'll be in the office, and I'll be here for worship on the 29th. And on the 25th, confirmation at 3:30. And that evening is the first of our monthly youth and family events. And that will be at First Lutheran Granville, beginning at 5 with a meal of what variety is yet to be determined. But and following that, I'm going to talk about the ministry of puppy raising. And well, probably all know, I've talked about it before, my wife and I do the puppy raising. And so I'm going to just give a little presentation on that. And I encourage any and all to come, because yes, you will get to see the puppy, and if you're really nice, you might get to pet the puppy. So that is on the 25th, beginning at 5 p.m. with the meal and the presentation to follow, and again, that will be at First Lutheran. With that, I will ask if there are any other announcements at this time. If not, I invite you to please rise as we join our call to worship printed in your bulletin, taken from Psalm 116. I love the Lord, who has heard my voice and listened to my supplication.
For the Lord has given ear to me whenever I call.
The cords of death entangled me. The anguish of the grave came upon me. I came to grief and sorrow.
Then I called upon the name of the Lord. Lord, I pray thee, save my life.
Gracious is the Lord and righteous. Our God is full of compassion.
The Lord watches over the innocent. I was brought low, and God saved me.
Turn again to your rest, O my soul, for the Lord has dealt well with you.
For you have rescued my life and death, my eyes from tears, and my feet from stumbling.
I will walk in the presence of the Lord in the land of the living. And for our gathering songs, our kids are going to come up and help lead us. And the first one, I will call upon the Lord, is an echo. So our kids will take the first part, and we as a congregation will echo them. Kristen?
Yep.
Let's do Sanctuary twice through. Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray together our prayer of the day. O God, through suffering and rejection, you bring forth our salvation, and by the glory of the cross, you transform our lives. Grant that for the sake of the gospel, we may turn from the lure of evil, take up your cross, and follow your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please be seated.
From the insult and spitting. The Lord God help me, therefore I have not been disgraced. Therefore I have set my face like flint, and I know that I shall not be put to shame. He who vindicates me is near. Who is contend with me? Let us stand up together. Who are my adversaries? Let them confront me. It is the Lord God who helps me. Who will declare my guilty? The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The second reading, James 3. Not many of you shall become teachers, my brother and sisters, for you know that we who teach will be judged with greater strictness. For all of us make many mistakes. Anyone who makes no mistakes in speaking of is perfect, able to keep the whole body in check, probably bridle. If we put bits into our mouths of horses to make them obey us. We guide their whole bodies or look at ships. Though they are so large that it takes strong winds to drive them, they are guided by a very small rudder. Wherever the will of the pilot directs. So also the tongue is a smaller member, yet it boasts of a greater exploits. How great a forest is set ablaze by a small fire. The tongue is fire. The tongue is a place among our members as a world of iniquity. It stains the whole body, sets on fire and circles of nature. And it's set on fire by hell. For every species of beasts and birds, of reptile and sea creature, cannot be tamed, and has been tamed by human species. But no one can tame the tongue, a restless evil full of deadly poison. With it we bless the Lord and Father, and with it we curse those who are made in the likeness of God. My brothers and sisters, this ought not to be so. Does a spring pour forth from the same opening both fresh and brackish water? Can a fig tree, my brothers and sisters, yield olives or grape black figs? No more can salt water yield fresh. The word of the Lord.
Mark 8. Jesus went on with disciples to the village of Caesarea Philippi. And on the way he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that I am?" And they answered him, "John the Baptist, and others Elijah, and still others one of the prophets." He asked them, "But who do you say that I am?" Peter answered him, "You are the Messiah." And he sternly ordered them to tell anyone about him. Then he began to reach the other Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. He said all this quite openly, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and looking at his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me." Satan, for you are setting your mind not the divine things but on human things. He called the crowd with his disciples and said to them, "If any went to become my followers, let them deny themselves and make up their cross and follow me. For those who went to save their life with lose it, and those who lose their life for any sake and for the sake of the gospel will save it. For what will it profit them to gain the whole world and their life?" forfeit their life? Indeed, what can they give in return for their life? Those who are as hands of me and of my words, and this altruist and sinful generation of them, the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Before you guys leave, I need you to take these backpacks and hand them off to people up there, please. Just hang on. Just get him back. This is too loud. Okay. So now we move down to the blessing of the backpacks, and I invite you to grab your backpack that you have been handed, and we will go through this liturgy. As a new school year has begun, let us ask God to bless students and all adults involved in their education. Lord God, we give thanks to you for our children and ask for your blessing upon them.
We receive our children as a gift from you to love and to nurture.
In baptism, we have promised to love them as members of the body of Christ.
We have promised to support them and guide them as they grow in their faith in Jesus Christ.
We have promised to surround them with a caring presence in worship.
We have promised to provide protection in the Christian faith.
Lord God, today we reaffirm our promises and ask you to bless our children and to empower us in our caring and witness in their daily lives.
Amen.
Lord God, we give you thanks for the ministry of and ask you to bless all who work with students, teachers, administrators, paraprofessionals, counselors, nurses, custodians, food service workers, bus drivers, coaches, and all who impact the education of students. Help them to view their work as a ministry, a holy calling which comes from you. Grant them energy, creativity, passion, and patience, so they might help their students discover and use the gifts you have given them.
Grant us the grace to support them and pray for them as they work with your loved children.
Lord God, all students are your workmanship. Each one is your masterpiece.
Let their minds be a place where creative imagination takes form.
Just as these backpacks will be carried with these students each day,
go with them when they get to school, and be with them in their classrooms, in the hallways, cafeteria, and on the playground.
When these backpacks are opened at the start of each day,
give them an extra assurance that encourages them for tasks like that.
When these backpacks get heavy with work to do,
give them the strength to finish their tasks with confidence that you have given them all that is needed.
When these backpacks are light,
allow these students to be proud of a job well done.
Bless each of these students, Lord, Let them know their unique, special purpose, and lead them to share your love with everyone they meet.
Help us to use the talents and skills you have given us to your glory.
God of grace, may this community of faith be a source of support, encouragement, and prayer for every learner and teacher, and all who have a significant role in the education of our children. We pray all these things in the name of Jesus Christ, our teacher and Savior.
Amen.
We join our song, This Little Light of Mine. Two longtime friends were sitting out on one of their porches one afternoon, and one says to the other, "You know, we've been friends for over 50 years, but I just can't remember your name." The other one thinks for a bit and turns and says, "Well, how soon do you need to know?" I wonder if we could reverse engineer that joke and tell it like this. I'm a little out of it. Who do you say that I am? How soon do you need to know? I know that really doesn't work. But if we were to ask our family and friends, who do you say that I am? What would be the responses? Or if a friend of ours asked us, who do you say that I am? How would you respond? We would most likely describe, answer that question based on our perception of the other person, our experiences, or whatever it may be. Because our perceptions go a long way toward defining our relationships, including our relationship with Jesus. And to kind of illustrate what I mean, I want to share a story with you. And I don't know the origin of the story. I don't know who wrote it. But the version I discovered, I read, was from Reverend Dr. Luke Bowman. And the story starts like this. Sam woke up in the middle of the night in a cold sweat. Blankets, covers, and sheets kicked off. His pillow had a big jumble at the end of the bed. He shot upright, looked around, looked at his clock. His dream had been so vivid, so real, that he had to collect himself and he couldn't get back to sleep. So he got up, went downstairs, and sat, thinking, puzzling over what he had dreamed. When morning came, he was still kind of troubled, so he called in sick and then called his pastor to see if he had time to visit. And so the pastor said, yeah, come by the office. Now, Sam hadn't had much one-on-one conversation with Pastor Jim over the years, but today he wanted to talk to him. He came in, they sat down, made small talk for a moment or two, and then he said, Pastor, I have to tell you about my dream. Pastor Jim said, you had a dream? Sam said, yeah, it really, really bothered me. Okay, go ahead. Sam started, I dreamed I had died. I dreamed I had died and I had gone to heaven. And as I was looking around, everything was deserted. Pastor Jim said, everything was deserted? Sam said, yeah, there were trees and grass and streets and buildings and houses. There were just no other people. Pastor Jim said, you got to heaven and there were no other people? Are you sure it was heaven? Sam said, well, yeah, it was heaven. I mean, Jesus finally came and he welcomed me. And I blurted out, where is everybody? And Jesus said something strange to me. He said, you were expecting other people? And I said, well, yeah, I kind of hoped, you know, maybe my family members who have gone before me, friends I knew, somebody, anybody else. I mean, am I the only one who made it? And Jesus said, no, of course not. Lots of other people. God loves everyone. I died for all of humanity. Well, Sam said, then why am I the only one here? Jesus replied, you remember your favorite hymn? You sang it nearly every day of your life, hummed it to yourself, thought about it. I come to the garden alone, you sang. And he walks with me, and he talks with me. But it never mentioned any other people. And when you talk to other people about your faith, you claimed me as your personal savior. Now, there's nothing wrong with that, but your meaning was private. How you imagined me in life is how you get me in death. So here I am, and here you are. Isn't this what you wanted? Sam concluded, and suddenly Jesus faded away, and I woke up. And I just wondered, can you tell me, is that what heaven is going to be like for me? Because if it is, I'm giving up my faith right now. Pastor Jim didn't give an immediate response. He sat back, rubbed his chin, thought for a moment. And he said, well, what do you think your dream is about? Sam answered, I'm not sure. Do you really think how I imagine Jesus now will affect what happens to me in heaven later? Pastor Jim said, that's a good question. I'm not sure. Why don't you tell me more about who you think Jesus is? Now let's leave Sam and Pastor Jim sitting in that office for a bit. We all wonder what heaven will be like. We all imagine that it will be full of people and all kinds of other wonderful, amazing things. But like Sam, I can't help but think that what we think heaven would be like has everything to do with who we think Jesus is. Who is Jesus for you? This is not a new question. In our reading from Mark this morning, Jesus asks his disciples the same thing. He says, who do other people say that I am? But then he says, who do you say that I am? It's a simple question with a complicated answer. because Jesus is not a simple man. Jesus does and has done and will do lots of things for lots of people, but the question before us today is the same Jesus asked the disciples. Who do you say that Jesus is? One way to answer the question is to carry things to the extreme, to the edge, and see what we find. That's what happened to Sam. In his dream, he was taken to the very extreme of his idea and his ideals and thoughts about who Jesus was, and at the edge of things, at the very place where his ideals met a version of reality, they collapsed. It didn't hold together. In Sam's dream, either Jesus was not able to deliver the promises Sam assumed that Jesus had made, or that the promises Sam assumed were different from the ones Jesus was making. We could say that in his dream, Sam was a victim of the old saying, "Be careful what you wish for, it might come true." But what about us? When we take our faith to the edge of things, where our lives meet the world, what does it mean to have Jesus as our Savior, as our Lord, as our Messiah? Who do you say Jesus is? In our gospel today, Peter had the right answer. He said, "You are the Messiah, you are the Christ, you are the anointed one of God, you're the one we're supposed to follow." Yet when Jesus sat his disciples down and began to teach them what it meant for him to be Messiah, Peter found himself on the defensive and takes Jesus aside. And to paraphrase, he says, "Jesus, get over here. What are you doing? Messiahs don't suffer. Messiahs don't die. Messiahs take control. Messiahs rule. Messiahs smash their enemies and put us in power." Answer the question, who do you say that I am? Peter had the right words, but not the right ideas. That ever happened to you, having the right words, but the wrong ideas? I know it's happened to me, and when it has, Jesus is very gently, kindly, with a wink and a smile, rebuked me, perhaps, as he rebuked Peter. Again, to paraphrase, saying, "You're thinking about what you want, about how you want to be in charge and control, and that's not what you get with me." For with Jesus, the challenging truth is, it isn't about me. It isn't about saving my life. It isn't about guaranteeing my spot with Jesus in heaven. It isn't about me at all. It is instead about Jesus and his way of the cross, his way of being in the world in service for the sake of others. Throughout his life, Jesus came to and found himself among, with, and ministering to the poor and the outcasts. And he found himself poor and outcast on a cross in his death because of it. Because he was not out for himself, but he was out for everyone else. And in this, Jesus says, true life is found. When we come to the point where we can say, yes, Jesus is the Messiah, the Christ, the Anointed One, who is the one who suffers and dies on the cross, we truly know who Jesus is. So let's go back into Pastor Jim's office. Sam talked a little bit about who Jesus is for him, and then Pastor Jim sat down with Sam and read this passage from Mark's gospel. Pastor Jim calmly, gently said, "What would happen if you would imagine your life as a Christian differently? What would happen if you would imagine Jesus' call to suffer and die for the world as your calling also? What would happen if your faith in Jesus Christ was personal, but not private, and sent you out into the world along with other Christians to proclaim that God reigns and brings healing, not brokenness? brings restoration of relationship.
What would happen and how would your dream turn out differently if you would see Jesus that way? Sam thought for a moment and said, "I'm not sure." Then he looked up and looked Pastor Jim straight in the eye and said, "But you're sure that heaven isn't like my dream?"
Pastor Jim said, "Yes, I'm sure." Sam, relieved, said, "Okay, well, I'll think about the other stuff." Pastor Jim said, "Well, tell you what, why don't we get together and talk about it in a week or so and you see what you come up with?" Sam said, "I don't know if a week is going to be long enough, but I'll call you." So they departed and agreed that they would talk again soon. But as Sam went home, he realized what he probably should do. What would do him a lot more good is if he would go back and listen to God a bit more and find out what God was actually doing in his life and asking him to do in return. And so he got out his Bible and read once again, "For what good will it do you if you gain the whole world but forfeit your life?" And then he prayed. About a week later, he decided that maybe, just maybe, during his lunch hour, he would go down to the shelter and help serve the meal to others once a week. He began to do that, and he started to feel a little better. And about a month later, he talked to Pastor Jim one more time and said, "I think I'm going to be okay." Pastor Jim said, "I'm glad." Sam said, "I'm working on it, but carrying my cross, that's not going to be easy, is it?" Pastor Jim said, "It never is. Amen."
We sing our hymn, "Jesus Loves Me." We pray with confidence for the church, God's good creation, and all who are in need. We pray for the church throughout the world. Form us into communities of forgiveness and grace. Help us to notice where you are calling us into new relationships, and give us courage to embrace the uncomfortable and unfamiliar. Merciful God, We pray for the earth and all its inhabitants. Protect lands at risk of wildfire and heal dying forests. Where fire brings destruction, raise up new growth. Guide us in tending precarious ecosystems. Merciful God,
receive our prayers.
We pray for those who govern nations, tribes, and cities. Open to them the cries of people in need. Direct them in shaping policies that prioritize the health and well-being of all who struggle with hunger and housing insecurity. Merciful God,
receive our prayers.
We pray for all who are ill, all who are lonely or anxious, and all who grieve. Especially we lift to you Miles Passa, Chase Jones, Carol Landa, Marcia Taylor, Dick Lundy, Donna Grilly, Elias Sheely, Stefan Zietz, Lane Johnson, Linda Frohenfelter, Dennis Lundy, Audrey Morrison, Dwayne Patterson, Jerry Anderson, Bob Bailey, Glenda Gottmesley, Cora Jez, Jean Bergsted DiAgostino, and Devin Kaler. Draw them close to you and soothe them with the promise of your enduring love. Merciful God,
receive our prayers.
We pray for teachers, professors, librarians, school administrators, staff, and all who support the education of young people. Sustain them as they shape learning communities rooted in equity and authenticity. We pray for children of all ages in their learning. Merciful God,
receive our prayers.
We remember our beloved dead, who with the great cloud of witnesses bear witness to your saving grace. Accompany us in our pilgrimage of faith, that we too place our hope and trust in you. Merciful God,
receive our prayers.
We entrust these and all our prayers to you, O holy God, in the name of your beloved child, Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you all.
And also with you.
I invite you to take a moment and share a greeting of peace with those gathered here as the body of Christ.
Thank you.
our offertory is a little special today. We are singing A La La La. So get ready to move around. Have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, the source of eternal healing, Your sins are forgiven.
Amen.
In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Lord, lead us into your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated. You may come forward. The table is ready. Will you please rise? And now may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen.
Receive the benediction. God Almighty, God most merciful, bless you, keep you, and give you peace.
Amen.
We sing our sending song, Note 1,
is an island. Sing, hum, sing.
Thank you.